You know, I know, we know, no matter what kind of a cardiovascular disease we deal with, we have to rely on left ventricular performance. Okay. For decades, the only major index, very useful but flawed, was ejection fraction, LV ejection fraction. We make big decisions based on that. But you know, LV ejection fraction is a summation of what goes on in the myocardium, not necessarily at an early stage. Okay. There are a lot of things go on. The myocardium is a really complex one with multiple layers. And disease process doesn't start in a full-fledged, advanced manner. Subtle abnormalities occur earlier than what ejection fraction can show us. So what we are doing is missing some early disease in many conditions. And over the years, there have been many attempts using multiple approaches and parameters to see whether we can recognize ventricular dysfunction before the EF becomes abnormal. Now, when tissue Doppler came into the picture, it really focused, made us focus on more things beyond ejection fraction, regional parameters, stress and strain parameters, and so forth. It brought us the emphasis on these parameters. And to get a better understanding on myocardial mechanics, that's the good news. The bad news is it doesn't work. Okay, it doesn't work. It's not really tracking the tissue. You put a sample volume somewhere. The biggest issue is the angle dependency. Another thing is the apical area you can see. We know apex plays an important role in many conditions and all that. That's where the technique of speckle tracking comes into play. Those who are not familiar, just to give a very brief example, is when we look at an ultrasound image, as you can see, it's not a uniform texture. There are a lot of bright spots, dark spots. They're called speckles, almost like a thumbprint. Each region has a thumbprint. Now, we can track that particular, any particular speckle over time. And if you look at this one, let's say this is end diastole and we are going to systole. You follow this. These are two different speckles. You can see them moving. So one can actually track the tissue. And truly, the change or the deformation that happens can be followed over time. Now, that's a two-dimensional speckle tracking, but you can also do it three-dimensional. The advantage of three-dimensional speckle tracking is this. When we do a 2D, sometimes whatever region we see, doesn't matter, any kind of imaging modality, in diastole may not be the same region in systole because the heart moves. And that's where when you put a three-dimensional speckle tracking, the whole thing is in the pyramidal volume of three-dimensional data. But that does not mean 2D speckle tracking is not useful. In fact, it's much easier to do. You can actually go and look at one of the instruments here, and you just put the transducer, push this button, and you get the data. Okay. And 3D requires, at least at the present time, a little more work of post-processing to get the information. This is what we use for regular speckle tracking, which we employ on a clinical basis, daily basis. And what do we get out of this? Okay, we get this. What are the different parameters? Sometimes it might be kind of intimidating. There's a lot of information that comes out. Displacement of a given structure, strain rate, rotation, twist, torsion. There's a lot of information. But few of them turn out to be really valuable in a clinical application scenario. Let's talk about a few parameters. One is called a radial strain. Strain is simply a change, deformation. Radial is wall thickening. Diastole to systole, it becomes thicker, and that's a change we are looking at. Circumferential is segment shortening around the circumference. Longitudinal, extremely valuable, shows the contraction or relaxation from base to apex. In a way, longitudinal change reflects many things that go on in different layers. And when we extract the data, this is how it will look like. There's a color code showing different segments, both in a short axis and a longitudinal view. This is an example of what we call the radial strain, that's wall thickening. And here is a display of the different segments, how much it contracts. As you can see, they are not identical because for the left ventricle to pump outward to the LV outflow, every region cannot contract identically. It's well designed. She did a great job in designing the heart. She meaning God, goddess, okay. And so this is a circumferential strain, similar parameters. Longitudinal strain, similar parameters. And you get all this information, but in addition to that, you get the conventional data on left ventricular diastolic volume, systolic volume, and ejection fraction. Beyond that, there are certain other things. You know, the heart has a ringing motion. It's almost like twisting a towel. So that there could be forward output, maximum efficiency, with the least amount of oxygen consumption. So one can study rotation, twist, and torsion too, but at the moment, they are not readily. Those parameters, I cannot say you can use this clinically to do this, but the other strain parameters are extremely useful. One could ask, okay, all these nice colors and the curves and the numbers, but how accurate are they? How well have they been validated? Both experimental work and clinical work compared to different independent standards, sonomicrometry or MRI, have shown over and over, these are just a few examples, validated the numbers you get are indeed reliable and reproducible. Now, let's look, even in this meeting and previous meetings and literature, abnormalities in myocardial function have been described in a variety of disorders. Okay, valve disease, different forms of cardiomyopathy, and ischemic heart disease, chemotherapy-induced disorder, radiation-induced disorder, and so forth. Today, we'll, of course, focus on ischemic heart disease. Now, as we follow the heart, there are kind of certain things are simple, easy to identify too. Let's say there is a color code, end diastole, and as you move into systole, the color changes. This is good. It's like looking at a weather map, okay? We know it's red or sunny versus blue, and for example, if this is a normal display, a kind of a polar MOP display, here's an example of a LAD occlusion in an animal model. This is a base, that's the apex. We can see while most of the region are okay, contract well, apex is markedly hypokinetic. And it's not just in animal models, clinical scenarios, whatever type of ischemic syndrome we can think. And here is a normal, and this is a peak systolic strain, and this is anterior, this is posterior, anterior antroceptal and posterior inferior. Here is an abnormality. Okay. Which territory is the abnormality? Inferior. See? So simple. Okay. So simple. Okay. And see, he's already an expert on speckle tracking. And here is another patient. Where is the abnormality? The apex. See, this is all red and this is dark blue. So one of the easiest way, wall motion abnormality is one of the most difficult things when we look at a 2D to learn and to teach. And this gives an easier display to appreciate that one. And this one has multiple regions. This is a patient with multivessel disease. Okay. So one is just recognition of a regional contractile abnormality. But beyond that, we get information on a global EF and so forth also. Now, in the detection of coronary artery disease, people with anginal symptoms or chest pain symptoms and so forth, compared to exercise test, this is this orange color, exercise test with a conventional echo, and exercise test, echo, and global longitudinal strain, that the blue color gives you the maximum sensitivity and specificity in the receiver operator curve. And this has been correlated with coronary angiography. And here is another scenario. 2D speckle tracking at rest, not necessarily with exercise, can help you actually identify coronary disease, not only recognize the presence, but also it's mild or severe. Here is another one, just to show you there is data documenting this. Longitudinal strain at rest, left main and three vessel disease, and this is just ejection fraction. This is a longitudinal strain. As you can see, it has a incremental information and ejection fraction doesn't help. It's not surprising. We have seen many patients with tight left main whose LV happily contracts, okay? And so this is where the subtle abnormalities that are not evident are brought into play. So if you put kind of pool studies, do a meta-analysis, and the sensitivity and specificity by itself is about in the 80s. But if you add it to the other clinical and other information, obviously it goes up. Now, think about it. We see troponin bump. You know, I get every day troponin bump, okay? And we don't know whether it's an NSTEMI or a real disease, hard to be certain. And most of them, at least two-thirds of them, end up going for coronary angiography. And this, I wouldn't go into the detail, but I just want to point out when you analyze the different layers, okay, using a speckle tracking method, and compared to other parameters, ejection fraction, wall motion scoring index, the layer-specific speckle data appear to be useful in the recognition of an infarction also, okay? And here is a patient, another example, showing a lateral infarction right here. And somewhat hypokinesia of the anterior wall also. And then when they go on to develop significant LV dysfunction, whether it's related to ischemic disease or related to non-ischemic disease, when they develop synchrony and heart failure, and dyssynchrony contributes a lot in many patients to heart failure, look at the dispersion of the curves and the lack of synchrony compared to the previous normals we saw. So is easy to understand the presence of dyssynchrony. And here is the same patient after CRT improvement. Not that everybody improves after CRT, but we can also gauge the efficacy of a given therapy, such as CRT, using this approach. And there's some data suggesting not only the systolic components, but when we look at the diastolic components of the filling curves, that might relate to the filling pressures. Here is a normal individual. Here is an individual with severe LV dysfunction and elevated filling pressure. Again, the early diastole, there are significant abnormalities in that. And not only some information on filling pressures that way, here is the actual correlation of an invasively measured filling pressure, LV diastolic pressure, versus the speckle parameters exhibiting a reasonably good correlation. Diagnosis, filling pressures, and then some prognostic information as well. This is based on a longitudinal strain. This is a survival. This is a follow-up from a nicely performed prospective study. One could see that if the speckle is normal, global longitudinal speckle, 14 to 18 is a normal range, okay? And then compare that with the people with a decreased strain, you can see the survival rate is lower. So there is prognostic information also is available. I can tell you, if you want to take ejection fraction, which I've been using for more than 6 decades, if there is another one important parameter you can include in a non-invasive evaluation, I showed you all the torsions, all kinds of data, pick longitudinal systolic strain, okay? And in future, people will not only be talking about ejection fraction, people will be talking about longitudinal strain on a regular basis as we do for ejection fraction. And here, that also predicts functional improvement after an intervention, maybe a PCI in ischemic heart disease. you can, no matter what kind of a statistics you employ, and compared to clinical, regular echo, the 3D strain predicts how well the functional improvement is likely to be. So, recognition of subtle abnormalities before the EF changes in ischemic disease and a variety of the other disorders, recognizing the location and the extent of contractile abnormalities and dyssynchrony, and diastolic mechanics, possibly some understanding of the filling pressures and of prognostic information. All this one could get both from 2D speckle and the 3D speckle. We need a little more robust data to kind of apply it on different disorders. And I was very pleased to see in the posters and abstracts in this meeting, there are so many disorders in aortic stenosis and cardiomyopathy, all indicating the potential of speckle tracking data in recognizing subtle abnormalities. 2D, easy to do. 3D is a learning curve involved, and it takes a little time, but it's just a matter of time that also becomes online, and eventually there would be also fusion imaging, more than one technique, echo and fluoroscopy, or echo and CT, and so forth. So the future is, in addition to EF, speckle. Thank you.